Welcome to AKS, Decoding of Ancient Indian History, 11th class textbook of NCERT. Although there are more than 100 books available in the market in order to learn about the ancient Indian history, but this book seems to be the most authenticated one as of yet, because whatever the any competitive exam, you can answer any questions from this book if you can understand it thoroughly. For that purpose, we have come up with a new series called as Decoding of Ancient Indian History. In the previous chapter, we have dealt with chapter 1. So now we are going to continue this series. We'll make sure that you're not going to miss even a single fact or an analysis which is important in this present textbook. I am Dr. Rachna. In the first chapter, we have seen why we should actually read the ancient Indian history, that is the importance of ancient Indian history, and the word how the unity in diversity actually came into existence in India, of which today we preach so much about the unity in diversity. And also we have seen about the what relevance of the past to the present, how why it is most important to have the past thoroughly read in order to analyze the present situations. So here in chapter 2, they're going to talk about the modern historians of ancient India. So here they're saying modern historians of ancient India. What does it mean? Does it mean that weren't there any ancient historians to write about the ancient India? Why should the modern historians have to write something about the ancient India? Now let us take an example. If I ask you to construct a kind of evidence for a particular thing, example you take, if I'm asking you to construct a crime scene, right? If when you have to construct about that particular crime scene, either you will take what are the evidences present over there at that particular place, what are the material remains which are over there, and who were the people who were looking at that particular scene, who were present when that particular crime was happening, and what was the communication that he has done previously, maybe through the phone or to the people whom he has talked, right? So all these things, you actually take them all into consideration. That is when you give the end result and write a crime. In the same way, when a historian has to write something about the past, even they have to take out a few kind of evidences or any kind of proof in order to prove that whatever they are writing about the ancient history or the ancient India, so that has to be true. It's not like whatever they say, if they keep on writing on the books, nobody is going to believe until they even properly quote about from where, what is the evidence on which they are coming to such conclusion. In the same way, the modern historians of ancient India has given lot of evidences in order to construct about the ancient Indian history. But a proper need to understand about the ancient Indian history was not done eloquently by the Indians themselves. Although the educated Indians especially have retained some kind of their traditional histories in the form of handwritten epics like Ramayana and Mahabharata or the Puranas and some kind of semi-biographical works, but the modern research in order to have an authenticated text in order to understand about the customs, laws of Indians was started in the second half of the 18th century because of the colonial administration which was set up by British. We know that East India Company just came as a trading company to India, so their main motive was just to reap the benefits or take the profits. But only after the Battle of Buxar, when they got administrative rights also, that is when they felt it very hard in order to administer the new or the foreign country people who would not understand their rules and customs. So because now the administration involves the inheritance of land also and their property, they found it difficult to administer the Hindu law of inheritance. Hence, in 1776, that is after Battle of Buxar happened in 1765, that is almost after 9 years, the first book that they have converted or translated into English is the Manusmriti, the law book which was given by the Manu. Right, this is the most hated book by the Dr. B.R. Ambedkar because it is the one who has written properly about the four varnas of the society and their jobs. So that is the reason the law book of Manu was first translated into English by the Britishers, and they have given the name called as Code of Gentoo Laws. So in order to understand the inherent laws Indians, which consisted of Hindus as well as the Muslims, so in order to understand about the civil laws of Hindus, they have associated the British judges with the Hindu Pandits and the Maulavis, in order to understand about the law of Muslims with the British judges, and they started to translate and to understand the civil laws of the country. Right, so for the first book which they have translated into English is Manusmriti, called as Code of Gentoo's Laws. Right, once the UPSC has asked about which book is called as so and so with what name, once they have asked this question, so in this perspect this becomes important. Remember, Manusmriti was translated as Code of Gentoo's Law, and now who has done it? We do not know. It must be a work of many people who were involved with the British judges that they have translated this Manusmriti. There is no clear name, but it must be a combination of many people. That's why they haven't mentioned the name who has translated this Manusmriti. This process of understanding the ancient laws and customs continued from the first half of the 18th century to the well into the 18th century too, and this has culminated in the establishment of Asiatic Society of Bengal. So this Asiatic Society of Bengal was established by Sir William Jones in 1784. Sir William Jones and two others, another person called as Will Kings, was also the founder member of Asiatic Society of Bengal, and he is the one in the next year after the establishment of Asiatic Society of Bengal has translated the most authoritative text which is considered by Hindus, was translated by Will Kings, who was one of the founder member of Asiatic Society in 1785. In the same way, Sir William Jones also have translated the Abhijnana Shakuntalam written by Kalidasa in 1789 into English. So after by 1800s, by having captured the Maratha region also, now they have extended this Asiatic Society where they have first established in Bengal. Now they have extended it to Bombay also, and in Bombay in 1804 they have established the Bombay Asiatic Society, followed by the Asiatic Society of Britain in London in 1823. So remember the chronology. I have marked them with the different colors. The societies, you can see them, like they can ask you to arrange from the ascending or the descending order, and the books that they have translated. The first book to be translated was Manusmriti as Code of Gentoo's Laws in 1776, followed by the Bhagavad Gita by Will Kings, then the Abhijnana Shakuntalam. So these are the books how they have translated in order, and the societies they have established. So during his work with the societies and the translation work which was going on, Sir William Jones, who was a civil servant in the East India Company, has made one kind of joint statement. In his statement, he told that European languages were very much similar to the Sanskrit and the Iranian languages. So the emphasis that the William Jones has made in his statements has aroused the interest of almost all the European countries, so as to see how the European languages are similar to the Sanskrit or the Iranian languages. So this aroused interest in the Germany, France, Russia and other European countries in the Indological studies. So this interest in the Indological studies that is talking about the how the Indian languages are similar to the European languages, that phrase they have called it as Indological studies. So in the whole of the half of the 19th century, many departments of Sanskrit were established in England as well as the other European countries. So here you can see how, in order to understand about the laws of the people on whom they wanted to have the administrative rule, have culminated into the establishment of one Asiatic Society of Bengal, then how they have even put it in the Bombay, as well as they have established Asiatic Society of Britain, so that the people who are mostly into the translation can sit at home in their Britain and try to understand about the laws of India, and then which will actually aid in the proper administration of the England into the India. In the same way, the one statement which was made by Sir William Jones has led to the establishment of many departments in the different universities of England as well as several other European countries. The greatest push to have Indological studies was done by the F. Max Müller, also considered as father of Indological studies. But the irony is that this particular person, who is considered as father of Indological studies, was most of the time spent in England, not in India. But the reasons that they have given so important push to the Indological studies, that is only after the revolt of 1857. This revolt came as an eye-opener. We know why there was a revolt of 1857. It was because the British failed to understand the customs and the laws of the people who were living over here in India and the administration which was being done by the British. So they felt that in order to have a smooth rule over India, because that was also crucial for them in order to transfer the raw materials to Britain, which was seeing the industrialization. So for that purpose, they started to give a great push so that they will be try to understand each and everything about the Indian laws and their customs. So they have tried to give a greatest push, and it was done under the leadership of F. Max Müller, right? So the after this revolt of 1857, they felt the need to have a deeper knowledge of manners as well as the social system, so as to rule over the alien people. Right. Not only that, this is not the only one reason why they were giving so much push to the Indological studies, but the Christian missionaries also wanted to find out the vulnerable points in the Hindu religion, so that by showing this kind of weak points to the Hindus people, mostly they would have shown about the caste system or any other inequalities, so that they can garner the support or they can convert the Hindus into the Christianity. So because of these two reasons, now they have started to translate all the ancient scriptures on a massive scale under the head of Max Müller, or under the editorship of Max Müller. This push have resulted in, like, altogether they have translated around 50 volumes of several books, and they have published them all under the name called as Sacred Books of the East series. Right. So remember that this Sacred Books of each series did not only contain the Indian text, but also it has the texts of Iranian as well as the Chinese. If you can remember, earlier we saw that how the William Jones have told that it is similar, the European language is similar to Iranian as well as the Indian languages. That's why in the Sacred Books of the East series, we can find that it not only contains the Indian text, but also it contains the text of Iranian as well as Chinese, but yet it was totally dominated by the Indian text alone. But this great person called as Max Müller, who has spent most of his time in the Britain, has something he has told in this all this 50 series. In their giving the introduction, he has made lot of generalization about the Indians. So having read so many of books, they have given in every textbook that he had to write in this 50 series of books, he has wrote about few things that we shall see. This generalization they have told about the nature of ancient Indian history and the society. So first thing they have charged the Indians is about the that Indians lacked a sense of history, and especially they said the factor of time and chronology. They said that is, if you can see most of our epics, if you can see, they have never given the place exactly they have happened, neither they maintain the chronology or the time, right? So never in this place, particular place, such Mahabharata happened, this was a time period after this, but just they went on to go on to write a story. That may be because most of the ancient Indian books were not written during that time. Whatever was written, usually they would use kind of birch bark things or the leaf kind of things they were writing. So because they will get decayed, and whatever the tradition was there was existing, like Guru Shishya tradition, oral tradition, what was happening through that only they have retained the ancient Indian history. That's why maybe they failed to write about the chronology compared to the Chinese also, where they have wrote the chronology as well as the time and place where exactly that history was happening. So this people have wrote that the Indians usually lack the sense of history, especially of the time and chronology. The second generalization that they have made is that the Indians were accustomed to the despotic rule. That is, only one king was ruling over the many people. Right. The third thing that they have given, the generalization that they have made is that they say that the people of India were so much engrossed in the spiritualism, right? So tantrism or the like bhakti, bhakti and all, especially this Indians were, they have engrossed in the spiritualism, and they only think of the next world, and they're not at all bothered about the problems of this world, right? So next world, how we talks like in the next janma we will be born so and so if you do this kind of karma, or how we show that bhakti, kind of things, whatever the spiritualism that the Indians were showing during that time. They said that these Indians were only engaged in the spiritualism, and they were particular about what will happen in the next world, and what should happen in this present world they were not at all totally unaware of, right? The fourth generalization that they have made is the about the caste system. They felt that this caste system was very vicious form of social discrimination, and the last one, they felt that the Western scholars especially stressed that Indians have neither experienced any kind of nationhood, just like how today we have India as a one nation. They felt that Indians has never had a feeling of nationalism, neither any kind of self-government, right? So all this kind of allegations they have done in this particular book of Sacred Books of the East, which was done under the editorship of Max Muller. So all these five generalizations have appeared in another book called as Early History of India, which was written by Vincent Arthur Smith. Right, so this book is again important because this book is considered as the first systematic history written about on the ancient India. Right, this book, which was based on the deep study available sources that which were written earlier by the Max Muller and his team, because this particular textbook served as a textbook for nearly 50 years, and still this book called as Early History of India is being used by the scholars, right? So in his book, the book which he has written, that Vincent Arthur Smith has written based on the deep study of the available sources. So obviously the available sources would be the Max Muller's text called as Sacred Books of the East. So one can guess what this Vincent Arthur Smith would have written in his book called as Early History of India. So obviously the five generalizations which were made by the earlier teams would have even surfaced in his book, right? So Smith's approach to history was mostly pro-imperialistic in nature, obviously, because he was itself a loyal member of the Indian Civil Services. So here he emphasized the role of foreigners into ancient India. So the European who has come into India was none other than the Alexander, right? So Alexander invasion has accounted for around 1/3 of his whole book. So he has shown like India was presented as a land of despotic rulers. And he goes on to say that India has never experienced a political unity until the establishment of British rule. And he goes on to charge that autocracy is substantially the only form of government with which historians of India were concerned. In sum, now if we can try to sum whatever the generalizations that they have made in the sacred books of the East series as well as the early history of India written by Arthur Smith, they were all trying to show India in a very denigrative character and achievements, and all that they were trying to do, their only motive was to say that or to justify the colonial rule that they want to go on, right? So as I told earlier, few of the observations that they made, like India lacked, Indians lacked the sense of history, like especially of time and chronology, was substantially correct. What they said is earlier correct only. When compared to the Chinese, yes, Indians have never shown a strong sense of chronology. Although, if here we can say, the early stage important events were dated with reference to the Gautama Buddha, right? So after Gautama Buddha, usually they have written a history in reference to Gautama Buddha. So all these generalizations made by historians were either false, because here we have given something reference to Gautama Buddha, or they have grossly exaggerated so that it will serve as a good propaganda material for them to have a rule of British rule in India, right? So their emphasis on Indian tradition of one man rule, that they were saying that how the Indians were only accustomed to the despotic rule, so that they want to equate it with the one man rule that they want to establish in India in the name of Viceroy. If they have told that Indians were just engrossed in the spiritualism and in the next world, so it makes a perfect case so that the British colonial masters have no option. But here, because Indians are only concerned with the next world or the spiritualism, now it is onus is on the Britishers to look after their life in the world, right? So here we are trying to show why they have given such type of generalization and what was their motive. But first motive, when they said that it is mostly the Indians only experience the despotic rule, that is because they wanted to establish a one-man rule of Viceroy. When they have told that Indians were only engrossed in the spiritualism and next world, so as to make a case that Britishers are here to look after the life in this present world. And at last, if Indians have never experienced something called as self-rule in the past, how could natives now, that Indians can manage their affairs in the present, right? So at the heart of all this generalization lay the need of demonstrating that Indians were incapable of governing themselves. That is why they had to accept the British's sovereignty. They have to accept the rule of British, and they are the one who are going to take Indians out of all these exaggerations that they have made. Hence, it is proved why they have made such type of generalization and why they have written so many books against the ancient Indian history. So obviously, isn't it making us feel bad? Whatever the ancient history they have written, it was mostly the generalization or the exaggerations that the Britishers have shown. So obviously, this came as a insult or a humiliating thing for Indians, especially who were getting educated at that time on the European lines. So this naturally came as a great challenge to the Indian scholars, as told, especially who were getting the Western education. So they were irritated by seeing how bad they have written about the ancient Indian history. Not only that, there are two things were irritating to them. One, about the way the Britishers were trying to portray the India in the text, and the second was within ourselves, within the society of India, which was like decaying of the feudal society of India, when they were comparing this with the capitalistic society of England, right? They were becoming very, very progressive in nature, nature, industrialization, all things were forth were bringing about. But these people who have visited England, they have also witnessed how progressive is their society. But they will come back to India, they could see some kind of feudalistic kind of society, which was itself the reason for India to be so backward. So now they took this as a challenge upon themselves, first to undo the whatever the colonial people has written about ancient India. They wanted to undo, and they wanted to prove, tell to the British government about the self-government which was existing earlier, right? In the Sabha, Samiti and all, we have witnessed such type of self-government in India. So they wanted to reconstruct the ancient India and show to the British people that what was the importance to give them the self-government, and also the social reforms they wanted the British to bring in the Indian society. So a band of scholars took upon themselves of not only the mission where they wanted to reform the Indian society, but also they wanted the reconstruction of the ancient history in such a manner that they can put this as a case before the Britishers for the social reforms in India. Because during that time, Indian society was plagued with the feudalistic kind of characteristic. So they wanted to rewrite the history, and they want to show to the Britishers that such type of history is existing in India. And now the onus is upon the Britishers to bring about some kind of social reforms in India. When they were doing so, writing the history, many of the historians were guided by the nationalistic idea of Hindu revivalism, right? You know that what do you mean by nationalistic idea of Hindu revivalism? One thing I have told in the last class about some people who feel like every good or every gold has come in the ancient India, but they try to forget that most of the social inequalities that we see today about the caste system and all has started in the ancient India itself, right? So to having said that nationalistic idea of bringing back the Hindu revivalism, it is like they're making a case even to bring back those kind of social inequalities. They were the one kind of people, but there was no dearth of the people who have become or who have adapted very, very rational as well as the objective approach in writing the ancient Indian history. To this very important person, very notable person who was coming from this category was Rajendra Lal Mitra, right? He published some Vedic texts and wrote books entitled under the name Indo-Aryans. He was a great lover of ancient heritage. I mean, last class we have seen what do you mean by heritage. Heritage is different from the culture. Heritage is what we inherit from our forefathers. Maybe the sculptures or the art and architecture that we bring about, right? Because he being a great lover of ancient heritage, he took a rational view of ancient society, and he has produced a beautiful page or the beautiful dialect in which he went on to show that how ancient Indians took beef, right? So this will be a very cautious thing. If had Rajendra Lal Mitra been here today, maybe he would have been lynched, because he's saying here that the ancient Indians took beef. So you know the arena, what's happening in and around the beef eating thing. Well, keeping the present aside, because we are talking about the ancient Indian history, so it is the first person who has written ancient India in a very logical and a very rational way. He has told all this in his book called as Indo-Aryans. Remember, Rajendra Lal Mitra has written a book called as Indo-Aryans. In this, he has showed a proper proof that how ancient Indians took beef, right? Now, others try to prove that in spite of its peculiarities, the caste system was not basically different, because here in the fourth case, they have told how the Indians were so much engrossed in the vicious cycle of caste system. So some historians like him, rationalist historian like him, have even gone to prove a case that they were trying to show caste system was nowhere different to the class system which existed in the pre-industrial and ancient society of Europe. Right, so this was a case put forward by the Rajendra Lal Mitra. So you must be thinking, is that we have to remember so many names about the names and the books that they have written. Actually, if you see UPSC question, they have never asked about such things. But there was a time that once they have asked about the Rajendra Lal Mitra, right? So we have also seen in economy, once they have given the names of few persons to try to know who were the economics in this perspective, right? So if you can revise, because I'm putting a proper case here, so if you can revise these names at least some 3 to 4 times, I hope at least you will be able to remember the names of them, if not the books they have written, so that at least you can eliminate in the options and come to the correct place. So kindly don't get bored, try to see this slide for some five minutes, 2-3 times in a day, so that you will perfectly remember these names, right? So now coming to the rationalistic approach, in the Maharashtra, there are 3 notable members which we have to know about them. The first one being the Ramakrishna Gopal Bhandarkar, right? He is as well as the VK, that is called as Vishwanath Kashinath Rajwade, and the Panduranga Vaman Kane. So these people have emerged as a 2 great dedicated scholars who tried to put together varied sources in order to construct the social as well as the political history of the country. The mention may be made of R.G. Bhandarkar, right, who tried to construct the political history. Remember what I'm just saying that these people were so much concerned about the just political history so as to make a case to the Britishers to bring the reforms, right? So here R.G. Bhandarkar also wrote political history of the Deccan, of the Shatavahanas, and the history of the Vaishnavism and its sect, right, and other great sects. He was a social reformer, not just the historian, but also he was a social reformer. Through his researches, he has advocated about the widow remarriage as well as to stop the evils of caste system and the child marriage. So remember, usually we get to see only Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar's name when talking about the widow remarriage. So remember his name of R.G. Bhandarkar or Ramakrishna Bhandarkar, who also made a case for the widow remarriage. Now coming to V.K. Rajwade, right, he also had an unalterated passion for the research. Like, he went from village to village in Maharashtra and in search of Sanskrit manuscripts. Manuscripts means, you know, which were written by the hand, right? The sources that he has published came into, like, he has published around 22 volumes about all the research he has done through these manuscripts, right? So, although he did not write much in these 22 volumes, but the thing that he wrote here was on the history of institution of marriage, right? On the history of institution of marriage, he has wrote a great deal that it is now till today also considered to be classic because of its solid base in Vedic as well as the other texts, and also because of author's insights into the stage in the evolution of marriage. So on the institution of marriage, the V.K. Rajwade has wrote a great deal from the Maharashtra region. Coming to another scholar called as Panduranga Vaman Kane, he was also great Sanskrit who was wedded to the social reforms, right? So he also continued the earlier tradition of scholarship, and his monumental work involves, like, he has wrote a beautiful book called as History of the Dharma Shastras. This he has published in 5 volumes, and now it is considered like an encyclopedia of the ancient social laws and customs. Now this would have enabled people to make a case of social process in the ancient India, right? So all this is showing, like, so all this shows like how the Indian scholars were diligently studying the polity and the political history of India so as to demonstrate that India did have kind of a political history And the Indians also possess a expertise in the administration, right? In this context, we have to give an credit to another person called as Devadatta Ramakrishna Bhandarkar, son of R.G. Bhandarkar, just now we have read, right? He was an epigraphist who published books on Ashoka and on the ancient Indian political institutions. So you know Ashoka, what he has done, so many reforms he has brought, and the way he had given the administration up till the northwestern part of India, how he has brought the land even which was under the Greek ruler called as Seleucus. So all this, he has wrote a proper kind of book on Ashoka and as well as on the ancient Indian political institutions, right? Not only him, the another person who has followed his line is Hemachandra Rao Chowdhury, right? He constructed the history from Mahabharata, right? Oh God, like from 5th century AD onwards, he has written up till the 5th century BC to 5th century AD, that is up till the Gupta's period, right? This person, Hemachandra Rai Chowdhury, because he was a teacher of the European history, he adopted some methods and comparative insights in writing this book, right? Although he did not discuss the problems. Of periodization, his history of ancient India stopped with the 6th century AD, that is after the Gupta's period. Now Hemachandra Rai Chowdhury's book is important because here whatever the V.A. Smith has wrote in the book, that is early history of India, so Rai Chowdhury criticized this V.A. Smith, you know, at many points. His writings are so marked by impeccable scholarship but show a streak kind of militant Brahmanism. Here, although he wrote properly how he has criticized V.A. Smith, the Hemachandra Rai Chowdhury, but somehow he will even criticize the Ashoka's policy of peace. So I told you they were very, very small. Those three persons that whom we have seen, three to four persons, have only taken the rationalistic kind of view in order to write the history of India. Another person, very notable person that we have read during our polity is also the R.C. Majumdar, right? He was also general editor of multiple publication. He has wrote a book called as History and Culture of Indian People. Remember, R.C. Majumdar wrote History and Culture of Indian People. So all these people, when the historians who were writing, always wrote only about the North India. They have never given attention to what has happened in the South India. Not many books have come. Even the most notable South Indian writer called as K. Neelakantan Shastri, he was from South India. He followed the same approach in his History of Ancient India. Right, he was also writing so much only keeping the perspective of North India, and later only he realized that there is no text to show something about the South India. That is when he wrote another kind of book called as A History of South India, and then History of South India is here, and followed by the same approach in his A History of Ancient India, right? But here again, Neelakanta Shastri emphasize the cultural supremacy of the Brahmins. So this again kind of brings a social inequality which was existing because of the Brahminical society, right? So but yet he has showed in his book, he tried to emphasize about the cultural supremacy of the Brahmin society, and also he highlighted that harmony that prevailed in the early Indian society. So under his leadership, several research monographs were produced on a dynamic history, especially on the South India. So all the six or seven scholars that we have discussed until then, everybody was so engrossed only to write about the political history. So until 1960, we see like political history has attracted the largest number of Indian scholars who have glorified the histories of their respective regions on the dynamic lines, right? But there were also a few people who wrote at the pan-India level because they were inspired by the nationalism. So in contrast to the book that was which was written by your V.S. Smith, that is the early history of India, a lot of books were published to show that how contrary he was or how badly he wrote about the Alexander in his book, in which he has dedicated the one third of the book only to the Alexander's invasions. But if you can see, these Indian scholars have given much less space to the Alexander's invasion. Instead, on the other hand, they stressed the importance of the dialogue of Porus with Alexander, as well as how Chandragupta Maurya has liberated the northwestern India from the Seleucus, to show how Indians have also occupied or have defeated the European powers, and how in the ancient India these two great rulers who have even subjugated the Europeans. This is what they want to show, right? But there are some scholars such as K.P. Jaiswal and A.S. Alkate. They try to overplay the indigenous ruling dynasties in liberating the country. So that and all they shouldn't have adopted, because many people have come into India, they have made India as their home, and they mixed and intermixed in such a way that today we won't be even to appreciate about what culture they have brought into India separately. Right. So all these findings, including the K.P. Jaiswal, who wanted to break the myth that the Indians were again with the despotic rules. So all this context was written in order to show how the five generalizations that they have appeared in the Max Müller, as well as the Vincent Arthur Smith's book, Early History of India, they wanted to destroy such type of myth, and they have given a beautiful books. Although some people have actually crossed the limits in over-exaggerating, but there was no dearth of scholars who have even wrote the ancient Indian history in a very rational way. So kindly try to remember the few names that I have mentioned earlier, so that it will be helpful for your elimination method at least. If you can see the slide for around like 2-3 times and revise it, I think that names won't be an important not important, it won't be difficult, right? So this chapter is again important. As I told, one question was asked from the UPSC directly from this chapter. That is the reason it is important. So until now we have been seeing how much they have wrote about the political history. None of them has given, the Indian scholars have given much importance to the non-political history during that time. It was the British historian called as A.L. Basham. He was a proper trained Sanskritist, and he has looked at India in a totally different way, and especially he was asking the ancient Indian scholars about with what authority or with what authentication were they writing the ancient history on the modern lines, right? So it is like this modern historians, how much they were plagued by the modern time, and they tried to emphasize or they were trying to write the ancient India from the modern perspective. It would have been better if they had wrote ancient India as it was the ancient India, but they were trying to corrupt the ancient India with the modernistic kind of view. This was properly challenged by the British historian called as A.L. Basham. So his earlier writings show the deep interest he had in the materialistic philosophy. Later he has even written a book called as Wonder That Was India, very very famous one, right? So in this book, he tried to give a very sympathetic survey of the various faces that the Indian culture and civilization it was having. But in this book, although he is also a British historian, he was not at all plagued by what the V.S. Smith had written. Because I told you, V.S. Smith's book was referred up till 50 years. So whosoever the scholars wanted to come to India, first they would actually read this V.S. Smith book, and they would like form a kind of prejudiced thing when they were coming here. So this guy, although he was also from the British, but yet he has taken a very rationalistic approach, and his book is totally free from the prejudices that were plaguing the writings of V.S. Smith. But important thing to be remembered here is that Basham's book was marking a great shift from political to non-political history that was happening around the 1960s. You know that they have started writing the books from 1783 or 84, when the Asiatic Society of Bengal was established. How Wilkins has transferred the Bhagavad Gita. So the Basham's book was totally a shift from political to non-political history. In this shift, another person, notable person that we have often heard about is the D.D. Kosambi's book, which the book is called as An Introduction of the Study of Ancient Indian History, and later it was popularized under the name called as The Civilization of Ancient Indian History in the Historical Outline. With that name, it got popularization. This Kosambi's book was a lit. It has actually brought a fire, because he totally brought a totally new kind of thing into the history. Up till now, nobody has given such type of focus or such type of direction to the writing of history. He set this kind of ablaze because he put a new trial into the Indian history. Here he went on to show that he tried to interpret or treatment the his treatment follows the materialistic interpretation of history, which is derived from the writings of Karl Marx. Like how he presented the history of ancient Indian society, here he put of economy, culture as an integral part to the development of forces of relation of production, right? That's what Karl Marx says. So he tried to give a Karl Marx kind of view into the ancient Indian history. So this D.D. Kosambi's book was a first survey book to show that stages of social and economic development in terms of tribal and class process. So although he was later criticized by many, but on the whole, this book was considered like a blaze it set up as, because he was trying to call upon the Karl Marx ideas. Of course, that was a modernistic idea that he has tried to put in. So here we can see, which has started in the 1700s to what we have seen today, like there has been a sea change in the methods, the orientation of those who were working on the ancient India, right? They were trying to give a greater stress on social, economic as well as the cultural process, and here they were trying to relate them to the political developments, right? So here this is very, very important to that of what was being written there. Only they were trying to write only about the political history. Now they are trying to adopt more and more scientific ways, because here they are trying to give more stress to the social, economic and cultural process, and this all included that they are trying to relate it to the political developments, right? Not only that, now we can say that the whatever is being written by ancient India is becoming more and more rational, because they are taking the account of the stratification of the text, and now they are even trying to compare them with the conventional nature, with the archaeological and anthropological evidences. So they are trying to become more and more rationalistic or scientific in nature. So whenever they are writing about the ancient India, they are trying to bring even the evidences of archaeology and the anthropology. In the starting of the session also, I told you how, if I am asking you to construct a kind of crime scene, how you will try to put on evidences to prove the case. In the same way, they are also trying to give this archaeological as well as the anthropological evidences to put their evidences. Not only that, a sea change we can see, because the Western writers also are no longer insisting that all the good things have come to India from there or the Western part. But yet still today also, some of them still believe that the religious or the ideas, rituals, caste kind of thing were the main forces which are actually driving the India backward. They also underscore various divisive features which made for the stagnation, right? So they are more concerned about the problems of stability and continuity, because they seem to be more fascinated by old exotic elements and they want to preserve them forever. So such an approach implies that Indian society has not changed and cannot be changed. Can this be a case at all? We know that how much India is becoming very, very progressive and how democratic we are, how we are far ahead with the same kind of Western kind of society. It means that here they are trying to show like underdevelopment is an integral part of India, of the Indian character. And we know that today in every phase, the India is giving a proper competition to the other Western worlds. Thus, the chauvinistic and the sophisticated colonists try to use this study of ancient India's past to, in order to show some kind of, to in order to prevent the India from making its progress. So therefore, it is essential to take a balanced and very, very objective move of the ancient India. So we have seen how exactly they have started with the history, when they have felt the need in order to write about the things that were important for them to rule over the administration of India, and how slowly they have made a progress, and what were the books, important books that they have published, and the Indians who have published some beautiful books. So these are the important facts to be remembered for both prelims, and if you can mention few of these facts in the mains also, it can garner you an extra mark. So kindly take a screenshot of this particular important facts about what we have read till now and the next one, so that you will able to remember. Even if they are asking the chronology, here we have with the dates even. So we'll continue with the next chapter.